Good morning, everyone. Continuing in our series of our new book by Gurudeva, The Seven Dimensions of the Mind, and this morning is The Third Dimension, Part 2. Earlier, due to the amount of energy dedicated to things of the second dimension, he was unable to cognize the third. Very little can be discovered about the third dimension from the second. It is from the perceptive and intuitive areas of the fourth that the third can be seen and understood in its entirety. It is from a conscious awareness of deeper dimensions that true understanding of the third dimension unfolds. By holding awareness stabilized in the fourth dimension, looking into the vastness of the fifth, sixth, and seventh, and simultaneously out to and through the third into the second, we know fully that the third dimension is a relatively small part of total mind substance, being only one-fourth of the fourth dimension in relative size and significance, with the second dimension being again half as large as that one-fourth. This then establishes a real identity on the inside of us, keeping the channels of sub-superconsciousness always open, and preventing the process of third-dimensional subconscious congestion. An outer-dimensional perspective, looking from the outside into the mind and trying to understand it, only results in partial concepts. We are unable to grasp the whole from such a vantage point. Similarly, we can learn about a city by traveling around the streets of that city and talking with selected residents. Generally, we learn one section of the city better and neglect others. Only by climbing to the peak of a nearby mountain can we study and comprehend the entire pattern of the city below. That overall vision or mountaintop consciousness is what the fourth dimension provides. Once that all-encompassing view is gained, we can enter any section of the city with confidence. If we were to enter the fourth dimensional state of consciousness, all of the time consciously withdrawing the pranic energies from externalized forces so that they do not exude out of the body, then the third dimension would cease to exist for us. For we would not connect up with the energies of other people or things. We could still observe the interchange of forces in others, but from another state of consciousness totally uninvolved. We would still have the third dimensional relation within our own mind, its fears, its thoughts, its habits, but eventually that too would dissolve as energies were continually drawn out of it. The third dimension is the essence of duality, the shifting of forces constantly. Within the changing world of the third dimension are two basic and intricate energy flows. The first is a flow of force between people and things. This is a one-way flow through which people relate to objects. The second is a flow between two people or more, and also between people and animals. Visualize a stream of energy generated in the body by the processes of life. This energy or prana constantly flows out from the central source of energy and constitutes the aura, constitutes the physical energy that moves the body, constitutes thoughts and feelings. This prana creates a force field around the body. As soon as two people associate, these forces interact, or the two energy streams interchange. Should these energies be of a like nature, the result is friendship. When we understand these energies as they combine, attract, and repel in human relationships, we then begin to discover the constituent parts of what we call the world. From the point of view of the second dimension, looking into the third, awareness is awed by the seemingly powerful feelings, emotions, and motivating forces of the third dimension. We feel victims of forces beyond our power to control. Generally, if we go into a study of the mind from this perspective of looking, in a sense, from the second dimension into the third and fourth, we analyze the surface by asking ourselves, why did this happen to me? Why did that happen? What did I do to deserve this? Many, many people live their entire lifetime in a conscious mind state, trying to analyze the subconscious and discover very little further efforts. Although the third dimension exists predominantly in the mind of man, it existed before human beings came to this planet. It does because the animal kingdom has its own third dimension. Compared to man's elaborately conceived system, the instinctive likes and dislikes of animals appear simple and basic. Animals cleave together in family and social units with the necessary rules governing acceptable behavior, division of labor, and so forth. The lions and the sheep do not get along too well. They have their own third dimension going on. Fear, hunger, and the instinctive drives live in action and reaction cycles within their nerve systems. In man, the instinctive cycles comprise a relatively minimal portion of the third dimension. Emotional and intellectual cycles are more prominent. All people have emotional cycles. They are not always cheerful, liking, and they are not always sorrowfully disliking. They are not always full, and they are not always hungry. A constant ebb and flow of the odic forces characterizes this dimension. It is always in flux, always changing. It has always been changing. The American Indians probably thought the world was coming to an end, and it was, their third dimensional world. Cities and buildings were replacing tribes and teepees. Automobiles were taking the place of the horse. Tribes were scattered, even slaughtered. The whole world as they knew and understood it, the values, the customs, the systems, the daily patterns of Indian life, all this had reached a certain pinnacle of vibration and was coming to an end. Another third dimension evolved out of that. Then another. Then another. Today some people think the world is coming to an end, and generally they inwardly mean their own world of values, ideas, or accustomed ways of doing things. For the average person, these changes come in undetermined intervals depending on physical body functions, immediate environment, and the status of the subconscious mind. These cycles govern and control life day to day. The general moods of friends and family, health, dreams and daydreams, good and bad fortune, local and national news, all of these, as they rise and fall in waves, dominate awareness. By allowing his emotions to explode, he naturally shatters the various rivers and currents of the third dimension, which have to be put back together in the same way that a shattered object in the second dimension is reassembled from the broken pieces. Sometimes it is not possible to reconstruct things exactly as they were. If he shatters the forces of the mental and emotional realm, he faces a period of healing while the injured nerves and feelings are harmonized. This is made easier if he understands what has happened, for he can then create a positive inner flow from the fourth dimensional area of the mind. Otherwise, should he continue to reflect unhappily on his actions and subsequent reactions, the event will be deeply impressed in the subconscious and become a more or less permanent part of his third dimensional ego identity instead of just another lesson in life. The second and third dimensions both have memory patterns which are different in nature. The second dimension has an instinctive memory pattern, and we therefore don't remember how the pattern came to be formed. For instance, we don't remember how a tree is made. However, through much research and scientific investigation, we can reconstruct our memory of the development of trees. We could say that the memory of objects in the second dimension is locked up in the objects themselves, available to us if awareness penetrates deeply enough. In the third dimension, memory is partially instinctive, but mingled with forces of the intellect as well. Depending on the ratio of instinctive to intellectual forces, this dimension will be gross or subtle. It's the end of our third dimension. We have some Shum words. The third dimension relates to the first three chakras. So I'll read the first three chakras in Shum. Akailisimbi. 1. The first of the primary chakras, named Muladhara in Sanskrit. 2. Attribute, memory, time, space. 3. Located at the base of the spine. 4. Color red, planet Mercury, element earth, sense, smell, petals. 4. Panchakshara mantra letter, Na. Second chakra. Ranamche Vum, named Swadhisthana in Sanskrit. Attribute reason, located at the navel. Color, reddish-orange, planet Venus, element water. Sense taste, petal 6, panchakshara mantra letter, Ma. Third chakra, Bivumbika, named Manipura in Sanskrit. Attribute willpower, located at the solar plexus. Color, yellow amber, planet Mars, element fire. Sense sight. Petals 10, Panchakshara Mantra letter C. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful day.